Good morning, everybody. I, Shriya Katyal, welcome you all to today's talk. We are at Marwa Studios, where we have our third Global Literary Fest, and we have with us Mr. Aman Hingorani, who has written a wonderful book on Kashmir, Unraveling the Kashmir Knots. So let's discuss his journey of being a writer and what was the motive behind writing this book. Welcome to Marwa Studios, sir.
Thank you very much.
So, sir, today I want to ask you that what was the concept behind this book, first of all? Like, if a writer writes, there's something in the mind, I'm writing for this purpose. So what was your purpose?
Well, I'm basically a lawyer, and but I'm also interested in academics. So I've written on several challenging issues. I was in search of a topic for my doctorate.
Okay.
And my father, who was a lawyer in 1944, enrolled in Sindh Court in 1946. That was before partition. Suggested that I research on the Kashmir issue, as he felt that every conceivable principle of law has been twisted and turned on his head to create this issue. So I started off as a legal research, looking at the rule of law, human rights violations, seeing the situation in Kashmir. So that doctoral research took me 6 years, and then I've updated it right up till now. And so this book is a slice of my doctoral research, of research for about 20 years. So it basically offers a brand new framework to resolve the Kashmir issue, because I have not really seen many lawyers examine the Kashmir issue. It's always seen as a political issue, and it is a political issue. But there are certain legal aspects of that issue which, if we separate from the political part, then we can get some movement on the Kashmir issue, because it's a political stalemate. How do you break the stalemate between India and Pakistan? The state is occupied, 20% of that is occupied by China. So you have three sovereign countries holding one state. So there is a political stalemate. There are human rights violations going on at every front, at every level, whether that of the security forces, that of the civilian population, both sides.
So I'm sure that you must have visited that place also to make your research more credible and viable. So what did you find there?
That is the point which I make, that to keep my objectivity, I made a conscious decision not to go there. My starting point was to get into the British archives to see as to why did we have partition in the first place, because my research shows that the Kashmir issue was created by the British as part of the strategy to partition India. Not only divide and rule. According the British official documents have recorded that the British, when they wanted, knew they would have to leave India, and they knew that the Indian National Congress is not going to support them in the Second World War. They decided to keep a slice of India, what we now know as the present day Pakistan, because at that time there was a great game being played between Britain and Soviet Russia. They didn't want the Russians to come southwards. So there's an Islamic belt right from Turkey to China, and the Northwest Frontier Province, northern areas of Kashmir, all fell within this Islamic crescent. So to keep that particular piece of land, it is the British who formulated the two-nation theory in 1940. It is the British who handpicked Jinnah to propagate that. The partition was scripted, and when Kashmir acceded to India, it is the British who did a coup. The Kashmir acceded on 26 October 1947. 5 days later, the British took the Maharaja's governor into custody, hoisted the Pakistani flag in what was then Indian territory, told Peshawar, you take it over. And they are the ones who had planned 1947 itself to keep this area and another area free from Indian control. That is what we call now POK, because if India went to Pakistan to recover the northern areas, it would liquidate Pakistan.
Exactly.
And so they wanted the buffer area. So it was the British officers of Indian-Pakistan armies who drew the ceasefire line.
And the consequences we are bearing till date.
And they sowed seeds of hatred, bloodshed, massacres. We are in perpetual conflict because they've created mutually hostile nations. They've affected the psyche of the subcontinent with the horrors of partition. So for me, it was a journey to get into from the British archives. I've got the facts, and then I've stitched together the argument that if this is the narrative, and modern-day India and Pakistan are creations of British statutes, then can we use law? Because as per that statute, the ruler was sovereign, wishes of people were irrelevant to see the accession of a state. The ruler came to India. The law which created India, made Kashmir a part of India. The law which created Pakistan, the same constitutional law, also made Kashmir a part of India.
Okay.
So if that is, can we use law to change, can we use law to break the political stalemate so that there's some change of political discourse, the political discourse gets altered and then we have a political process. So if you go through the book, I've documented how it was India which, when Kashmir came to India, we said, no, 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 it's provisional. It's India which gave a disputed territory status on Kashmir. It's India which went to the United Nations. The politics behind it I've documented. It is India which internationalized the Kashmir issue.
But the mind was always like Britishers behind it. They were just being instruments to them, right?
Yes, but then our political leaders of Vande Bharat India were so naive that they felt they could not rise to these challenges. So, one is of course the British role, but what happened to our far-sighted thinkers and leaders? That they fell in this trap. Because the entire subcontinent has been taken for a ride, whether it's Pakistan, India or Bangladesh. So, the book documents about how it is New Delhi, which conferred a disputed territory status, internationalized the Kashmir issue. So if today you want to say Kashmir is part of India, we say so, the world doesn't agree because we created a dispute on the title itself.
Exactly.
So in that case, what do you do? And my suggestion is go to the ICJ to get your title confirmed. Go now, if example which I gave, that if I have a house and I say, well, I'm not too sure it is my house. Then some people get in. I say you get out. They say you don't know the title to your own house.
Exactly.
You need some title. Yeah. So I say, well, you're a terrorist. They say, no, this is a freedom struggle. Unless you get rid of the disputed title, how can you assert this is your place? And the only body in existence on which is binding on the international community, which is authoritative as far as the international community is concerned, is ICJ. At the Hague.
So what do you believe, like, where is the problem coming? Why don't they take the initiative and clear this, sorted this out? Like, since you have written the entire book, you must have thought of that also.
We have had a very bad experience in 1948 where the United Nations Security Council failed India. And so our political establishment is scared to get back onto the international stage. So they send shivers down the spine to even think of going back. We keep saying it's a bilateral issue. But it can't be a bilateral issue when a state is occupied by three sovereign countries, India, Pakistan and China. It is an international issue. And we need to get back to the international stage, but to a judicial body, because legally we are entitled to the entire state. Kashmir issue is not the valley. Kashmir issue is POK. Kashmir issue is northern areas. We're entitled to the entire state. And if we get a finding from the ICJ that India is entitled to the entire state, it will alter the political discourse on Kashmir. And even if we don't succeed in the ICJ, and the ICJ says wishes of the people are relevant, we fall back on our existing stand, which we already have, that the State Constituent Assembly was elected. It formulated the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. So wishes of people have been ascertained, and they want to be with India. So we have nothing to lose.
But they have to take the initiative.
So law cannot resolve the Kashmir issue.
But definitely it can make it better.
But law can change the political discourse on the Kashmir issue. So that it can change the whole concept, the context of the Kashmir issue. Nobody can then say it's a freedom fight going on. So by law, you can change the political discourse in India's favor. End of the day, it has to be resolved politically, no doubt. But if we keep seeing gross human rights violations and say stop it, it's not going to stop till you get rid of the disputed territory status. So that's where, as far as I'm concerned, it's an academic piece of work. I deliberately did not want to go to Kashmir to get biased or prejudiced or be swept away with emotions because of the sufferings at all fronts, whether that of the inhuman conditions in which our security forces function. They are used as fodder. They didn't create the Kashmir issue. They don't have the solution to the Kashmir issue.
Everybody is confused, basically. I can say that.
Apart from being confused, they are doing something which they've been asked to do when they're not responsible for the mess in the first place. So if people, you can't have an entire population as terrorists, everybody's disillusioned with you and you're supposed to maintain law and order, there's bound to be human rights violations.
I really hope that the book you have written, it's going to inspire people and the politicians basically, and will make them take an initiative towards this side. They should give their thought to this issue. It's a very big problem we are facing.
Yes. It is a longest standing dispute, 70 years, but then the positive. I'm optimistic about it because we did go to the ICJ for Kulbhushan's case, Jadhav's case. So we are now inching towards using the international stage, not a political body like the United Nations Security Council, but a judicial body like the ICJ.
And why to fear when your purpose is clear? There's no fear for that. So one more question. I would like to know that since it's a very serious topic and serious issue, so is it only all the facts and figures or some creativity, creative writing is also incorporated in your book?
Well, the feedback, the feedback which I've got on the book is, in fact, what M.K. Raina said, and you can see the clip, he's talked about that the structure is such that you have one main trunk and then you have small stories and big stories, and they're all intertwined. They go in millions of stories, but they're all joined onto the main trunk. So the idea is the book is structured in such a way that I'm presenting the facts, let the people judge. I'm not deciding for them. I am presenting,
it is
the facts are there. My evaluation of the facts are there, but at the end of the day, let the people decide what's right, what's wrong. Because you cannot govern countries even by law, let alone violence. You need public opinion.
That's right.
And to create the public opinion, the people must be informed of all the facts. So the purpose of this is to dig out facts which have been buried over the years, present them in a particular context to see, well, this is why we had the Kashmir issue. This is where we have fumbled or where we have made a mess of it. This is a possible way forward, and let the people decide.
Thanks for sharing your views and your wonderful concept. I'm surely going to buy my copy, and I hope that everybody else is going to buy that too. Thank you, sir. Thanks for coming to Marwa Studios. So guys, this was all about unraveling the Kashmir knots. I'm sure that you have got lots of information about this serious issue. I'm going to buy my copy of this book for sure, and I hope that you are going to buy it too. This is all for today, but Aishwarya Katyal will be back very soon with another celebrity guest in today's talk. Till then, you keep watching MSTV Har Pal Aapke Saath.